Welcome to your Artsy Girl podcast. I am your host, Christina Carrere. This is a podcast about art, poetry, and anything about creativity. Sit back, relax, and get your dose of brain food to get your creative juices flowing. Hello, everyone, and welcome to episode 7. Today's featured guest is Kristy Bowen. She is a writer and book artist working in both text and image. Kristy Bowen is the author of a number of chapbooks, e-zines, and artist book projects, as well as several full-length collections of poetry, prose, hybrid work, including SALVAGE by Black Lawrence Press in 2016, and Major Characters in Minor Films, published by Sundress Publications in 2015. She is based in Chicago and runs Dancing Girl Press and Studio, and spends much of her time writing, making papery things, and editing a chapbook series devoted to women authors. Let's welcome Kristy Bowen.
Hi, Kristy. Welcome to the show. I'm so excited to hear that you were interested to come on the show and be my featured guest this week. I have known you now going, 9 years or so, because back in 2010, I reached out to you and pitched to you my chapbook for publication, The Art of Exporting, and you so aptly accepted, and the rest is history. The reason why I reached out to you and wanted you and your press to represent my work is because of the gorgeous chapbooks you make. And more importantly, you support women writers, particularly emerging writers. Can you tell me how long Dancing Girl Press and Studios has been around, and how did you even start up the publication? Like, which came first, the studio where you sell your trinkets, paper goods, arts that you've created, or the chapbook series? How did you do it all as a one-woman shop?
Dancing Girl Press sort of spun out of an online journal that I had started in 2001 called Wicked Alice. And probably about a couple years into that, I decided that I wanted a sort of print incarnation of that. And I was trying to figure out a name for it. And I had this giant poster of a can-can dancer in my apartment. And it occurred to me that Dancing Girl Press sounded really cool. And thus the name was born.
That's amazing. Wow. I always wanted to ask you about that. How did you come, come up with that name? And I believe I believe that can-can poster was the famous painting by Toulouse-Lautrec. The amazing knowledge I have sometimes. I'm like, okay. Let's see. So first, before I go on, I'd like to tell the audience about what this whole, the whole operation, the whole not just the Dancing Girl Press chapbook series, but the whole umbrella. I mean, I derived this. I'm going to read what you have on your About Us section. Okay. So, an indie press and design studio based in Chicago, Dancing Girl Press and Studio creates a variety of open and limited edition books, art, and paper goods, as well as various ephemera inspired gifts and accessories. Since 2004, the annual DGP chapbook series has been devoted to publishing innovative writing by women authors in delectable handmade editions, as well as exploring the intersection of writing and the visual book arts. We also publish Wicked Alice, an occasional lit zine. Our workspace is located on the 9th floor of downtown Chicago's historic Fine Arts Building, a gorgeous structure with over 100-year history of housing the arts. From time to time, we open our doors to the public for salons and open studios, as well as make book fair appearances and host readings throughout the Chicago area. Proceeds from the shop go toward furthering our publishing efforts and myriad other projects. We also welcome donations to help us do what we do. And you do such fantastic work, I must add. So, And you had stated, I read somewhere that you work as a librarian.
Uh-huh.
And that you started your operation in your home apartment.
Initially, the first few years of Dancing Girl Press were happening in my dining room, which is a little unruly as far as papers and printers and mailing supplies.
I can imagine.
I moved into the Fine Arts Building, which is great because we have like a lot of space. At the time, the sort of other things that we offer, paper goods, trinkets, my visual art, were sort of used as a way to fund that space because the chapbooks weren't selling, you know, that much. Right. Over time, we've been doing, you know, we're in the black now, but the extra funding for that and paying the rent actually helped a lot. We used to have a shop on Etsy where we sold vintage as well. So the proceeds of all of that sort of funded the press initially.
That's amazing. Wow. So you had just thought up the idea of the press while you're working at the librarian desk, right?
I work the evening shift most of the time. I still do. And so it put me in front of a computer for long stretches of time where I was sort of waiting for students to need something, for people to help. And at the time, I had finished grad school and I was working in the library, but I was writing, but I also wanted to somehow be involved in sort of literary community. So since I was on the computer so much, I decided, well, I'm going to I taught myself very rudimentary coding and built a website, and thus that started Wicked Alice.
So you coded the website yourself?
Very, very rudimentarily.
Well, this was back in what year?
2007? Yeah. Or 2001. Yeah,
when we think about the history of the internet, and I remember, 2007, we didn't have like a fancy WordPress or anything, the plug and play kind of things. Yeah. Well, yeah, you did straight up coding. And wow.
This was actually 2001.
Yeah. Oh, so yeah. That's way back when.
I paid for the domain and I was using, I actually still use, there's a Lycos, which used to be a search engine, has Angel Fire.
Oh my God, Lycos and Angel Fire.
Oh, yeah.
That's going way back when in internet history.
It still exists. Actually, the homepage for Dancing Girl Press is actually still hosted through Angel Fire.
Wow.
It bounces to Shopify, which is the online store platform that I use. But so it was basically a matter of altering templates to get them to look how I want them to look.
Right. Yeah. Shopify has great, shopping cart features, displays. Yeah. Well, I have to say, you are an awesome poet yourself. In fact, I had purchased one of your books then called Fever Almanac, I believe. I noticed that Nebraska has been a big chunk of your childhood because it shows up in your work. Do you still feel the pull of that era in your aesthetics?
My mother is actually originally from Nebraska. I grew up in Northern Illinois, shy of the Wisconsin border. And I feel like I did go back and forth between Nebraska and Illinois a lot when I was a kid. And I think the poem in the Fever Almanac that's called Nebraska is actually about my grandmother who got married when she was 14 and then proceeded to have, you know, about three kids and then pick everything up and move to Illinois.
Wow.
And sort of, I always think of the difference between our lives. I mean, when I was 14, I was going to slumber parties and drinking a lot of Mountain Dew.
Right.
Here's my grandmother, with children and this halfway across the country move. So I feel like Nebraska always embodies this sort of ruralness. Actually, to me, Illinois doesn't, or the part of Illinois I grew up in doesn't have, because Rockford, where I grew up, is very much a sort of Rust Belt kind of feeling, it's a, kind of a fallen industrial town. And so when I think rural and I think the countryside, I always kind of think Nebraska, Iowa, even though very much of, you know, Southern Illinois is actually very rural.
Right. Well, the reason why I brought that up is because I did feel a sense of being drawn to the place, and your poetry had a lot of texture to it. You know, so what are your goals as a poet these days? What are your own personal projects? I know you had sent me two samples of your two chapbooks that you had worked on. Can you tell me a little more about your projects?
I'm usually working on a bunch of different things all at once, and I some things have been going on for years and years and I never finish them, but occasionally I do. Those two samples are actually part of the zine series that I issue on a yearly basis. Subscribers can pay for a subscription, and then every month or every couple of months I'll send them like a book object or a print, or a little like artist book. And those two projects are actually from last year's series, but I've been trying to work largely in tandem between the visual and the written. I'm also working on a series called the Poet Zodiac, that is zodiac poems for every sign in the zodiac. I initially started and was going to do one for every month. That was a little over ambitious, and so now it's every season, every zodiac sign, and I've been posting those on Instagram, kind of as I go along, so people can kind of
add you on there. I gotta check this out. Do I have you on Instagram? I don't remember, but I will definitely search you out. Okay. well, I want to make mention of the two chapbooks titles because they are both exquisite collections. The one is How to Write a Poem in a Time of War, and the other is the Science of Impossible Objects. I like those titles alone, you know. I mean, those definitely draw me in to read them, and I've read them and they're fantastic. So how do you come up with these? So how do you come up with the ideas to these to your work? You know, does the whole, when you see and read other people's work, does it feed into your ideas also?
I tend to write, most of my projects are sort of built around little obsessions that I have.
Okay.
At the time. Well, to take the Science of Impossible Objects as an example, I had stumbled on Pinterest. It was a board of pictures of things that, it was like something about my imaginary daughter. Like, this Pinterest board had like a like photos of like clothes that you would put on this imaginary daughter, and like things that they would do. And it was kind of a humor thing. Like, it was like, oh, my imaginary daughter eats, you know, organic vegetables, or only, you know, she only wears this certain brand of clothes. And it was hilarious, and I watched it for a while. And I don't have children, and I have no plans to have children, and I was like, wow, what if I were to write a series of poems to this imaginary daughter? And so they became very strange. And actually at the end, like, it really wasn't so much about this imaginary child. It was more about like my relationship with my art. I think the poems are actually my imaginary daughter.
Well, that's what I thought about, you know, not the literal, you know, daughter.
Right.
You know, when you think of our art, they are children, right? So, so yes, see? And who would have thought that you would get ideas from Pinterest? But, you know, it's right. I can see it, because I am drawn in Pinterest, putting those search criteria, or just stumbling on ideas, you know? Mm-hmm. And the things that come up, I can see how. And in fact, I don't know if I may have gotten an idea, too, from that also. Well, thank you for sharing that. That is truly, enlightening. Do you make the book designs yourself to these chapbooks that you make for the women writers?
Usually, there's a couple different ways that I approach sort of cover art and the visual interpretation of the book. Sometimes I'll usually start by asking them what they have in mind, like what they would like to see on their cover. And sometimes they have definite, specific ideas. Sometimes they have artists that are their friends or, designers that they want to work with. We don't have a budget for cover art. So really it's basically if they can get their friend to let us use it for free, that's great. And other than that, like usually what happens is they'll present me some ideas, things they like, colors they like, things they hate and definitely don't want on the cover. And I'll design something from scratch. Tend to be in the sort of meat I work in, which is like collage. I do some like more graphic, more like diagrammatic covers. So I definitely have a look. The nice thing about using other designers and other artists is that it gives us a variation, because I think when I've been doing too many covers, they start to look alike. So
I do see the diversity in the style, but they also have a commonality to them. Interesting. Mm-hmm. It's almost kind of macabre a little, or, you know, a little with some humor, dark humor, you know, sometimes it's like, you know, pow in your face kind of thing. And it's, you know, if you haven't, I'm just speaking to the audience, if you haven't already, please visit dancinggirlpress.com and certainly look at through the chapbook series, and you'll know what I'm talking about. It's beautiful, beautiful representation there, visual representation. So aside from price, making full length collection, you know, as the maybe downside of creating full length collection as opposed to chapbook, what made you decide to just stick with the chapbook series? Chapbook meaning it's 20 to 30 pages of poetry. Right?
Yeah.
As opposed to full length collection.
Yeah, initially it was just a price thing. Back in, 2004 when I started, I was a grad student at Columbia, which is also the library I work in. And so I had like a little bit of extra student loan money, I think. And I was like, oh, I can do this for like, under $100, because, it varies. Like, now I use a little fancier paper, a little better printers. But at the time, like, it's basically you have a saddle stapler and some printers and you can do it. Like, and so that wasn't the initial aspect. But I also over time, I really, really have learned to appreciate the idea of a little bit shorter of a series of poems and the ability to sort of read them in one sitting.
Right.
And what you can do chapbook, like that sort of shorter concentrated burst of writing. I find that it impacts like what I do, because like as a writer, like I tend to write in these sort of series of poems that are, anywhere from like 10 to 30. And then usually I'll put those together to form like, they start to constellate around certain themes. And so then I end up with a full length. But I really like the idea of just sort of a shorter series of work.
Yeah, that's great.
There's also something really nice, like the tactileness of sort of a handmade book, and the capabilities of doing stuff that is sort of expanding the idea of what a book is. So like a couple years ago, we did basically a book of poems that is a bunch of paint chips or like paint sample chips called the Glidden Poems. And it was a series of poems and drawings on paint bowls. And we put it in a little envelope and fanned around. And it doesn't look like a book, but it's really cool.
You mean the paint sample thing you get from the hardware store?
Yes.
Oh, wow. And then so you printed out her poem on that?
Yeah, they were paint samples that she had composed them on. I just reproduced them for the project. But
Oh, so it's okay. So this is what you call the intersection between poetry and book art.
Those are sort of, we've done a few projects that are sort of expanding that idea of, mm-hmm. of the book. A few years ago, Rebecca Dunham wrote a series of poems based around Emily Dickinson's herbarium. I have a hard time saying that. And so we included it manifested as this box of broadsides of the poems and pictures from Emily Dickinson's archives in a book in a box.
So what compels you to keep doing what you're doing with such a full schedule? How do you manage your time?
I know. Sometimes, right? Sometimes I'm still trying to figure that out. It seems like there definitely isn't enough hours in the day to get done all of the things that I would like to. Usually I spend at least 2 to 3 hours in the studio before I go to my job at the library. And while I'm there, depending on what's going on there, I can, you know, look at galley, design a cover. I stay up really late too. I'm usually up till like 2 or 3 in the morning, working or editing things. Mm-hmm. It's always a struggle. And sometimes it feels like certain things fall by the wayside. And then, you know, you're putting out this fire over here and you're putting out this fire over here.
Sure.
And then, oh no, something else is on fire. But yeah.
So how many submissions do you have on average?
We're open every summer, usually during from May through September. We get a little over 500 now.
Wow.
It's grown.
That is truly amazing.
I was thinking one of the hardest things, I wrote a blog entry recently about the hardest thing about starting a press wasn't so much working out the logistics of like how to put out a book. It was getting people to send you work. That was one of the biggest challenges I had back in 2004. Yeah. It's just a matter of word of mouth. I think like people hear about it and then they're interested, but getting that initial word out was definitely took a couple years.
And we now get 500. You know. Submissions.
Right, yeah.
So it's amazing.
Like maybe, I think the first year we were open, it was like maybe 10 submissions, of which I took like 5, you know? And then now, you know.
It starts with an idea first, right?
Right.
And then it's the, you know, mapping it out, the logistics and the execution, you know? And you just work at it and perfect it and mold it, and, you know? And lo and behold, you get 500 submissions now, and yeah, and you got the full blown studio, and you've been operating now for how many years?
15.
Wow.
15 total from when the first chapbook came out in the fall of 2004.
Wow.
The image, it was a collage, and I ended up, basically I did that, and then I was like, ooh, I kind of like this, and it ended up turning into like a series of 5 different pieces. And wow. I'm like, oh, well these need like a textual component. So the last couple of weeks I've been working on poems that go with them. So in that case, the inspiration, which was actually her book to design this cover, then spiraled into this whole other thing. So that happened quite frequently. What's interesting is I just started working on, I had designed, this is in the last 2 weeks, I had designed a cover for a chapbook called Phantoms by Naomi Washer. Okay. And most of my work at the library is kind of routine and kind of boring. But I do get to sometimes host programming at the library, so I make a lot of posters for things.
Uh-huh.
And occasionally I'll work on a poster for like a reading or a workshop, and I'll be like, ooh, wow, I really like that technique, and then it'll turn into like this series of art for my own purposes.
There you go.
Yeah.
Well, Kristy, it's been great talking to you and catching up on things. I wish you the very best of luck, and thank you for all the awesome things you keep doing for women writers, giving them a platform and doing such exquisite book designs and visual representations.
Thank you for inviting me.
Oh, you're very welcome. Very welcome. Well, everyone, that is it for now. Please tune in next week for my next feature guest. In the meantime, have an awesome, productive, and creative week. Bye, Kristy.
Bye.